Hi everybody, this is our first lecture on LTE. We are a new startup in Sydney, and our main area of focus is consulting for wireless access networks and training for LTE and 5G. So in this first lecture, we are actually discussing LTE voice services. And the first part basically is regarding the types. So basically we have two types of voice services. The first is CS FallBack, and the other is voice over LTE. In this lecture, we are basically discussing CS FallBack, and in the next lecture, we will have a detailed discussion of voice over LTE. So as you can see, I've divided this into some basic parts, and the details will be provided in the lecture once we go into the details. So you can see the types, that is CS FallBack, voice over LTE. Then we are the major, you can say, the areas of discussion for CS FallBack. One is mobile terminating paging through the SGS interface. Then we have the FallBack procedure to 2G and 3G. Then we have the call setup in the legacy network. That is your actual, basically, call setup. And then we have the return to LTE. So there are different KPIs which cover all of these four aspects. And these are the features that will be discussed in the training. SRVCC, that is single radio voice call continuity. Then we have the back switch handover. Then we have the RIM DMCR, which basically helps in reducing call setup times. Then we have the IUCS Flex MSC pooling, that is to deal with the case of mobile terminating paging. Then that is MTRR, MTRF, that is again mobile terminating redirection retry, and then the redirection forward. So that is also deals with the mobile terminating paging issues in CS FallBack. Then we have these major issues that will be discussed in the training, that is mobile terminating page failure, CS FallBack failure, call setup time, and return to LTE latency. So this is the part or the summary that will be discussed in the lecture which is coming next. I hope you guys enjoy it and feel that you have gained some knowledge. And if you have any questions, this is our website, winink.com.asian, and this is my email address. Feel free to contact. Thank you very much.
Hi everybody, this is the first video of our web series for a comprehensive overview of LTE and the various aspects related to design, planning, optimization, and evolution to the 5G system. In the first lecture, which is divided into two parts, we would look at the voice services in LTE and explore how they have been conceptualized and delivered in the LTE system. This is important also in terms of the ongoing deployment of voice over LTE across the globe. Voice over LTE will be discussed in the next part of this lecture, that it is the go-to voice technology in the future telco ecosystem once the 2G and the 3G CS service cease to exist. In the first part, we will discuss CS FallBack, which uses the legacy network 2G, 3G for providing the voice services. This is essential since it is expected that CS FallBack would be used at least for the next 5 to 10 years across the globe as an LTE voice service, in addition, of course, to the voice over LTE as we move to the large-scale and ubiquitous deployment of LTE. CS FallBack is also very important as not all of the LTE user terminals, you can say, or the mobile phones are capable of voice over LTE. So for some time, the operators will have to have the CS FallBack capability in the LTE networks. In LTE, voice services can be provided via two options. The first one is known as circuit switched fallback. In case there is a requirement for voice services, the mobile or the UE falls back to the 2G or 3G legacy network and uses the circuit switched voice services of that radio access network to perform a mobile originating call or mobile terminating calls. The UE releases its LTE connection, and therefore any services being run on LTE would have disruptions and lower data rates in the legacy network. So basically, to summarize it, the voice services are not provided by LTE network, but there's a mechanism in the LTE network which can basically transfer the UE from the LTE network to a legacy network to provide the voice services. The second option for voice services in LTE is voice over LTE. This is a voice over IP service which uses LTE's IP network to perform voice services. Voice over LTE uses IMS, the IP multimedia subsystem, to provide voice over IP service and the rich communication services. We will discuss voice over LTE in the second part of this lecture. The evolution of voice services in LTE is divided into three stages. The first stage, which in many areas is already over, was the one where all the voice services were handled by CS fallback, that is by falling back to legacy networks such as 2G and 3G. In the second phase, which is ongoing in many places around the world, is a combination of voice over LTE and CS fallback. This means that some areas, mostly metro CBD areas, have voice over LTE services, while the outer metro regions still use the CS fallback features. Here in Australia, we have three major operators, and the majority of them have now voice over LTE services on their majority network. However, they still have CS fallback services option available because people have still use UEs which are non-voice over LTE. In order to provide continuity in the voice services, features such as ISR VCC and PS handover have been introduced. SRVCC stands for Single Radio Voice Call Continuity. This feature enables the UE to hand over from voice over LTE to 2G, 3G based voice services and vice versa as the UE moves between areas which have voice over LTE and the areas which have CS fallback services. And similarly, PS handover uses the same technology to provide interruption-free services for the data bearers. So let's have an overview of CS fallback. So we have the CS fallback at a glance. The first thing is that the UE falls back to the legacy 2G or 3G networks for voice services, and it is based on circuit switch mechanism. So that's why we have the name circuit switched fallback. As evident, there will be a break in the data connection with LTE as we are moving from LTE to a different radio access network. And correspondingly, there will be impact on data rates for the corresponding applications using data. For example, if you're using streaming service in LTE, for example, with carrier aggregation or anything else, all of those services will be stopped because you are moving from an LTE network to a legacy network. So the user will have that impact on those data bearers, and that will be evident in some of the services. Another thing is that the UE returns to the LTE provided all the network conditions are met once the call has been finished. And of course, there's a significant increase in the call setup time as compared to the normal calls made on the 2G or 3G network, because there is an additional time which is required to fall back from the LTE to the legacy networks. The conditions referred in terms of returning to the LTE network refer to the appropriate LTE coverage and some other network features and settings. There are multiple ways to return to the LTE that can be implemented, and that of course will be discussed later. The increase in call setup time as discussed before is because of the signaling messages being exchanged between different network nodes to enable the CS fallback. We will also discuss this in detail in the coming slides, and also the methods used to reduce the call setup time. The type of voice services in LTE is described by the UE whenever a UE attaches to the LTE network. So the UE basically tells the network that what kind of voice services it would use or it would prefer when it initiates a voice connection. So in the initial attached request for the network services, the user specifies the type of voice services it is capable of and how it would want the network to provide the UE with the available features. The first two cases are straightforward. That is, the first case is CS voice only, so the mobile is only capable of CS voice only. The second is IMS PS voice only, so basically the mobile only has the capability of voice over LTE. The last two cases are the mixed cases, where the mobile has both the CS fallback and voice over LTE option. In the first case, the CS voice is preferred. So if both voice over LTE and CS fallback are available in a particular eNode B or a particular part of the network, the UE would prefer the CS fallback. And in the second case, the UE will prefer the IMS PS voice preferred. And if you see the log file analysis, which probably we can have in our detailed training on site or online, we can show basically whenever the UE attaches, it provides this information in the attach message. In this slide, we will have a brief overview of the CS fallback architecture. SGS is the interface between the MME and the CS networks MSC. So basically, SGS provides an interface or a communication interface or a communication protocol between the MME of the EPS network and the MSC of the legacy network. So basically, this is the interface which provides the communication channel for the MME to access the MSC for enabling the CS services for a particular user or a particular mobile which is camped in the LTE network and has to fall back to the legacy network. This is the main interface which enables LTE to use CS services from the legacy network. And within this interface and within the CS fallback procedure, we have the RIM and the DMCR options. The RIM stands for Radio Access Network Information Management, and basically is a feature in which some of the system information can be provided to the eNode B and onto the mobile before it fallbacks to the legacy network. This helps in reducing the setup time, because the UE has some information prior for the 2G and 3G network. We will study in detail about the RIM relationships between the LTE cells and the legacy 2G and 3G cells. And the DMCR is basically delayed measurement control reading. So what happens is that to reduce the call setup time, there's a feature in which the UE skips some of the SIBs for the system information, and after receiving the SIB 3 in the legacy network, it can skip SIB 11, SIB 12, and onto SIB 13. So that is basically a feature required for improving the call setup times. So now we will explain the RIM functionality in a bit of more detail. As you can see on the figure on the right hand side, basically we have our eNode B, MME, our SGSN and the BSC, and you can see how basically the information is relayed between all these nodes to collect the RAN information. Basically SIB information, by SIB information I mean the system information block for the UTRAN and GRAN cells can be shared with the eNode B. So therefore, before the UE falls back to 2G and 3G systems and then basically starts to search for an appropriate cell to camp and basically make the call, and the information can be provided prior to that fallback to the user, and therefore can make a quick decision and basically the call setup times can be reduced. So a cell in the legacy network can be defined to have a RIM relationship with an eNode B. So if a mobile is camped in a particular eNode B, so it will have information for all the cells in the GRAN and in basically the UTRAN for which the RIM relationships has been defined. RIM information is exchanged between the MME and the SGSN, and in any change in the system information for the 2G and 3G cells, then that change is communicated via the MME and SGSN in the corresponding LTE cell. So there is an S3 interface between MME and the SGSN, so that this information can be exchanged via that interface. So in these slides, we will basically explain RIM, that is the RAN information management, in a bit of a detail, and how basically the UE interacts with the network to get that particular information and how it impacts the call setup time. As explained previously, the system information is relayed from the 2G, 3G network to the eNode B via the S3 interface. Basically, the communicating entities between the two networks are the MME and the SGSN, and then basically they correspond to their respective entities. In the LTE side, it is the eNode B, and on the legacy side, it is either the GSM cell or the 3G cell. Requests are sent via the MME to SGSN, and then the information from the RIMC and the BSC is relayed back. The UE basically does not need any system information when accessing the new target RAD cell, because it has already taken that information via the SSGN and the MME link and through the RIM feature. So as you can see in the on the picture on the right hand side, that it basically explains the process of RIM via the S1 and the S3 interface, and you can see when the UE is basically accessing the new RAT, it does not require to access the system information and then do all the cell selection, reselection, calculating the margins and selecting the appropriate cell. Therefore, it has there's a lot of improvement in the call setup time, and basically that is the main benefit of RIM. DMCR basically is the delayed measurement control reporting. This is also a feature which is used to reduce the call setup time. Once basically the UE has accessed the new radio access technology, that is a 3G, basically it will read the system information block 3 for initial access to the radio access technology, whatever it is, and then it basically it will skip SIB 11, SIB 11 bis and SIB 12 to reduce the call setup time. And this is a feature which can be enabled in the UTRAN, and basically provides significant improvements in the call setup time. In a detailed training, we can also provide the comparisons, how much the call setup time improvement can be achieved from RIM, how much can be achieved from DMCR. So those details can always be discussed in detail in an on-site and online training sessions. Now we will look at the relationship between CS fallback and the tracking area. So basically, CS fallback is configured in the network based on the tracking area of the particular LTE. So each tracking area can have a CS fallback enabled or disabled. So basically, when the UE is moving from a CS fallback to a non-CS fallback area, so the RAT, that is the radio access technology, will be selected accordingly. So basically, the point is that in a network-wide implementation, the CS fallback is implemented on a tracking area basis. In CS fallback, combined attach is a feature which basically helps the LTE network to basically have the UE has an attachment to the non LTE network, that is your 2G or 3G network. So basically, EPS is a packet-based system with no CS functionality. So therefore, if you have to make a CS-based voice service, you will have to go to a legacy network. So in the combined attach procedure, it provides the functionality of attaching the UE from the initial attach request to both EPS and the MSC slash VLR of the legacy network. So basically, GUI indicates the request for combined attach in the attach request. As you can see on the right side, if you see the signaling, we have the attach request, and basically the attach request contains the EPS attach type 2, that is the combined EPS and MZ attach. So EPS attach is for the attachment in the MME, and the MZ attachment is for the attachment in the MSC. Initial attach with MME, and then the MME sends the LAC set, is the tag and LAC mapping and other info to the MSC VLR. In the attach accept message, there will be the LAC location area code and the MZ for the registration with the MSC. So the UE will know that to which LAC and which MSC it belongs. So the MME has the TA and the LA, and LA and MSC mapping. So basically what happens is that in the LTE network, the UE moves around in areas which are defined as the tracking area. However, in the legacy network, it is either the routing area or the location area. So what happens is that in MME, we have a mapping between TA and LA, and whenever a UE attaches to the MME sees to via the mapping to which LA the UE belongs, and therefore it connects the corresponding MSC. The attach accept message contains the TA, the LAC, and the TIMZ. And in a similar way, the detailed message can be combined. So when you are detaching from the network, it can be EPS or MZ, or it can be both. In this slide, we will discuss the CS fallback options. So the first option is that we redirect based CS fallback to 2G, 3G. And then the redirect based CS fallback to 2G, 3G with the system information block. And third option is the redirect CS fallback with the DMCR option. And then of course we have the PS handover based CS fallback to 3G. As on the right hand side snapshot, you can see that the first redirect fallback is with RIM and the second is without RIM. So basically what is happening is in the first case the UE already has the system information, so it basically measures the 3G cells and then basically camps on the appropriate cell. And in the second option, it basically reads the system information for target cells and then moves on to camping and the call setup. So that additional time basically shows up in your call setup time. And once in the detailed training, we can see that how much of an impact that call setup time can provide. And rest assured, in CS fallback, this setup time can also be observed by the user because it is significant. In this slide, we will see the CS fallback redirect options that are preferred options in the live networks all across the world. So the first option is release with redirection basic, so that is a blind redirect with no information available to the UE, and so basically it will go on to a next to the legacy network and then basically read the system information and then decide accordingly to camp to a particular cell and then of course initiate the call process. The second option is release with redirection and the SIP skipping, so basically that is a DMCR option. And the third option is enhanced with redirection, and that is the system information tunneling. This option was available from release 9, and this is basically the RIM option. And of course the call setup time reduces as we move from the first to the second and to the third. In this slide, we will have a quick look on the CS fallback call flow, and that is for the mobile originating call. As you can see on the right hand side, we have the UE, E-node D, and the BSS RNS, then the MME, And then we have the legacy network, the MSC, SGW, peer packet data gateway, and the SGSN. So in the first part, the extended service request is sent from the UE to the eNode B, and then the eNode B basically sends the message for the MME for an SNAP request with a CS fallback indicator, and then it gets the response from the MME, and there's basically a context update messages exchanged between MME and eNode B. And then after those context update, basically the RRC connection release is sent by the MME to the to the UE. So basically, and that RRC connection release contains the redirect methodology. And once the UE has been redirected, that means that the UE has fallen back successfully to the new RAT, that is the legacy RAT, then it sends the CM service message to the new radio access network, and the normal call procedure follows. And in this case, when the UE sends the message for a new service request, if the lag attached to the UE is incorrect, then there will be a reject message in case of wrong lag, and then the UE will again go through a location update, and after the location update, then the normal call procedure will proceed. In this slide, we will discuss the CS fallback, but for the mobile terminating call. So the scenario is that any user is calling a mobile which is camped in LTE network, and once the user is paged, the mobile has to come from an LTE network to a legacy network. So the UE is paged via the SG interface. So as we discussed previously, SGS interface is the interface between the MSC and the MME. So whenever a user is user which is camped in LTE has to be paged, it basically is paged via the SG interface. So MSC checks if the SG status is null or active. So if the SG status is null, it means that the user is not camped in LTE. It must be in the old legacy network. And if it is active, it means that it has to go through that SG interface to page the mobile. So paging parameters in MSC need to be set for SGS paging, and as we discuss these matters in detail, for the call setup times for mobile terminating calls, the paging parameters, the number of times a page is done, the interval between paging, and the paging frequency that can be optimized. So that, as in the next point, we are discussing paging times, paging intervals, A/IU paging, and SGS paging after SGS paging failure. These kind of parameters can be optimized to basically improve your call setup performance and your call setup time as well. MME performs checks on the UE attach, the LTE-A mapping, and then informs the MSC. The UE then performs the call procedure from the extended server request. The TA/LA mapping is available in MME. So basically, MME maps each of its tracking area to a particular location area. And location area is the only parameter used in MSC for paging, even with the use of SGS interface. So whenever MME with the SGS interface with the MSC basically periodically updates the SG. The MSC regarding the tracking area for the particular user. So whenever there is a wrong LA's TA mapping, there will be call delays and even a call failure. So what happens is this: that if the empty the mobile terminating call has been sent to a location area which belongs into a different MSC, that can result in a call failure as well. Because what happens is that the page was sent to a particular MSC with a particular LA, that MSC via the gateway MSC connected with the MME through the SGS, And when the MME it contacted the MME, so MME then calculated the LA, and the location area is incorrect. So when the location area update happens, it connects to a different MSC, and that MSC has no record of that particular page. So that is how the TA LA mapping is very important in the mobile terminating call for CS fallback. And if you have any issues, you can basically and this is a bit complicated in understanding, so basically I will repeat it, that whenever a user is paged, the paging will be done on the location area basis, and location area is attached with a particular MSC. So when a user is paged to a particular LA, the page goes to a particular MSC, and via the gateway MSC, the basically MME is connected through the SGS interface. When the page comes to the MME and the tracking area belongs to a different LA, then the location update procedure takes place. And if that location area is in a different MSC, so what happens is that the new MSC will have no record of the page, and therefore we will have a mobile terminating call failure if we do not have basically the required features available in the system. So that is how the mobile terminating call acts. And the LA-RA mapping is used to provide a reference for the tracking area. So basically what happens is that the location area and the routing area, being the legacy networks, are more mature, so they basically provide a baseline for your tracking area planning. And the tracking area needs to belong to only one location area, but one location area can have multiple tracking areas. As we described in the previous slide regarding the failure of mobile terminating calls because of wrong lag, and if the wrong lag is then updated by a location update procedure, and the UE ends up in a lag which belongs to a different MSC, this can result in mobile terminating call being failed, and therefore that's a CS fallback failure. There have been different features which deal with this issue. The first feature is MSC pool architecture, also known as IU/APLEX. In this feature, basically MSCs are bunched together into pools. Basically, one pool contains a number of MSCs, and therefore one lac, if basically any page for one lac, will be basically communicated into multiple MSCs, and therefore a larger area, larger geographical area, will have the information for that particular page. In the second feature, basically we have the mobile terminating roaming retry. So what happens is that if the page was given to the old MSC, and then after the location update, the UE belongs to the new MSC, then the new MSC basically communicates its information to the old MSC, and the old MSC basically then communicates the information to the gateway MSC. The location connection is released from the gateway MSC, and then again the subscriber information and the paging information is sent to the new MSC. And there is, so in this case, then from the new MSC, the call alerting procedure is initiated, and then basically we'll have the mobile terminating call placed by the original mobile. In the third feature, which is basically an advancement of mobile terminating roaming forward, the subscriber information and the information which is actually transferred from the gateway MSC to the new MSC in the first place, when the new MSC communicates the information acknowledgement to the old MSC, the old MSC, rather than going back to the gateway MSC to get its connection released, and then the gateway MSC communicating towards the new MSC, the old MSC transfers all the information of the page and the route and the subscriber information to the new MSC, and then the procedure can take place. So basically, in the second feature, there is a reduced amount of time. as explained in the previous slide, in this slide we can basically clearly see the difference between MTRR and MTRF. If you see in the steps after the second step, basically in MTRR, the old MSC basically resumes the call handling, releases the connection from the gateway MSC, and then the gateway MSC sends the information again to the new MSC, and then the new MSC basically sends the acknowledgement, and then the new set of procedure is started. In the MTRF, basically after the second step, when the location of the subscribers is removed from the old MSC, the old MSC itself provides the subscriber information and the roaming number to the new MSC, and the setup procedure can just take place. So therefore, the reduction of time of the old MSC connecting to the gateway MSC, releasing information, and then the gateway MSC again transferring information is removed in MTRF, and therefore we have improved performance in certain terms of call setup time. Of course, as with both of these features, in MTRF there is increased coordination between the old and the new MSC, and therefore the required network dimension needs to go into place. After the discussion around CS fallback architecture and the different procedures involved and the call flows for mobile originating and basically mobile terminating calls, we move to CS fallback performance optimization. CS fallback basically can be divided into four categories. The first part is the paging procedure for mobile terminating CS fallback. The second part is the CS fallback procedure itself, basically where the network falls back from the LTE to the 2G or 3G network. Then basically we have a normal call setup procedure in the legacy radio access network, and then we have the return to LTE procedure. So as you can see on the diagram on the right side, the paging procedure, basically there are multiple issues that can happen. You cannot be paged during the tracking area pair procedure, LTE coverage issues, you cannot be paged during reselection between radio access technologies. These all issues are basically more related to RF optimization and the lag in tracking area optimization. Then we have the fallback and access to target cell optimization. The first is the fallback failure, and the fallback failure can happen due to a number of reasons. Number is the wrong 4G to 2G, 3G neighbor relationships. We can have neighbor optimization, margins, and etc. Then we have the CS call established failure, the MSC port issue. Then we have the CS call established failure, non-optimal frequency of the target RAT. Basically, when you send the RRC connection release message, we have the target frequency in that message as well. And that target frequency depends on the chosen radio access technology according to the priority set in the network. Then we have the CS call established failure, the pseudo base station issue. We have the abnormal detach procedures as well. A number of reasons that we will discuss briefly in the next few slides. Then we have the return back to LTE. There are reselection issues, and there is fast return failure. So in that part, how we go to the go back to the LTE, there are different procedures for that, and we will discuss that briefly in the coming slides as well. The first part of the optimization for CS fallback relates to paging procedure for CS fallback. There are a number of reasons that need to be checked and optimized to improve the performance. First is the wrong software version of the network that can cause an issue. Then we have the frequency locking for the terminal. If the frequency is locked to LTE, it will not be able to go back to 2G or 3G. Then we have the terminal software problems. Then we have 4G weak coverage. Basically, if LTE has a weak coverage, the network from the legacy part will not be able to reach the UE. Then we have users interested detach, where the MME detaches the UE from the network without informing the UE or the MSC side. And then we have the tracking area update and other procedure conflicts, so that during which the paging cannot reach the UE. And for these kind of issues, basically we have to optimize the paging timers and the paging intervals on the SGS interface between the MME and the MSC. And the next optimization step is for the CS fallback procedure, where the mobile basically falls back from the LTE to the legacy network. Then many issues can occur which can result in a low CS fallback success rate. And number one is CS fallback function of the eNode B is not enabled. So basically what happens is when the user wants to make a call using the legacy network, eNode B does not have the available function and the CS fallback will fail. Second is that 2G, 3G frequency configured in eNode B is incorrect. So basically whenever the redirect release message is sent to the UE, it basically redirects it to the wrong frequency, which basically ends up in a CS fallback failure. Then basically we have the weak coverage of 4G target network. Then we have the fallback to different MSC pool. And that is an earlier issue that we discussed, where we have in the end empty CS fallback failure. And then we have the pseudo base station case, where in 3G or 2G we have a base station basic and other information which does not exist in the network, and therefore the CS fallback will fail. The next phase is basically the call setup and the call setup procedure in the legacy RAN. The call setup procedure can also fail if the CS fallback function of 2G, 3G BSC, RNC is not enabled. So basically if the RRC connection release has been sent to the UE and the LTE, once it falls back to the 2G, 3G network, they will not accept basically the call and it will fail. The other reasons are incorrect settings for core network parameters. Then we have the call setup issues in the legacy networks that involves the entire RF optimization procedure for a normal call setup. There can be issues while accessing the network, there can be congestion, there can be coverage issues. Then we have the setup times during this normal call setup, which can be improved via the SI system information tunneling or the skipping of the system information that involves DMCR and RIM. The next optimization category is for the return to LTE procedure, and it is also very important because if there are issues in then the UE from returning from the legacy network to the LTE, it will impact the UE performance in terms of data specifically. There are a number of issues which can happen when the user is returning from a legacy network to LTE. First is reselection failure. Reselection failure can happen because of a number of factors. Then there is reselection with redirect to LTE failure. Then we have the fast return failure. Then we have poor coverage issues. Then we have the LTE network implicit detach. And then we have the wrong setting of the cells reselection priority. So usually in the signal reselection priority, we have to prefer LTE. But if the cell reselection priority is incorrectly updated, then we can have cell reselection issues towards LTE. Now we can also have another overview of the major optimization issues. So the first issue that can happen is the failure before the fallback, and that is usually the SGS paging failure or paging success but fallback failure. So the paging failure can happen because of a number of procedures as we described previously. There can be some issue on the network end, there is a mismatch of the software, terminal issues. Major issues usually because of a procedure already happening with the UE, for example, the tracking area update. Then if we have the paging success, then we have the fallback failure. So fallback failure can happen because of the assignment failure, because of the call drop, because of the wrong settings in the 2G, 3G network, because of the wrong neighbor setups in the E-node B2 2G and 3G relationships. So that is some of the reasons that can happen. In order to recap the entire optimization and KPI monitoring process, we can basically have we have this tree diagram where we move from low CS fallback originated call setup success rate. So first we see that if the fallback ratio is high or low. If the fallback ratio is low, then we can have basically two issues. One is this CS fallback originated call setup reject, and that is because of can be because of UE authentication issues leading to implicit detach, which we can basically analyze through the ENM calls. Then once we have established that the number of requests of CS fallback is basically compromise of the reject, and then there are other failures as well, then we can basically see if the UE is searching the correct rat. Basically for that we need to see if the correct settings are available in the E node B and the correct rat and frequency was nominated in the RRC connection release message. Then we have the UE context modified failures, when basically during the fallback procedure the context modified failure has been you can say that it can be because of a frequency handover, and we can basically analyze it through the failure cause. Then we have the number of UE context setup failures, and that also we can analyze through the failure cause. So all of these causes were for low CS fallback ratio. Then we can move towards high CS fallback ratio, but our success rate is still low. So one of them, the reason can be that we have an authentication failure after fallback to 2G and 3G. That is basically primarily a 2G 3G issue. Or then we can have the issue of UE going to the wrong rat. First is again the incorrect message in the RRC connection release. Then we have the incorrect feature enabling of CS fallback in E-node B, and then we have the misconfigured neighbors for LTE and the 2G and 3G cells. The attach issues which UE may suffer can also impact the CS fallback performance. There can be low attach success because of poor coverage issue. Then we can have high attach success ratio, but we are ending up with abnormal attach issues. In abnormal attach issues, we can have an APS only attach. Then we can have an attach where the CS fallback is not preferred, and then we can have an attach where we have only SMS services. So all of these abnormal attach procedures also result in a lower CS fallback success. Then we have attach success ratio, but the attach complete ratio is low. So basically the attach has been a success, attach complete message has been sent to the UE, but the UE has not received it. So it is basically usually in a poor coverage situation. So in general, we have to see the attack issues as well if we are having low CS fallback success ratio. As explained in the previous slide, abnormal combined attach can also cause CS fallback failure. As you can see in the right diagram, basically we have multiple cases of combined attach where the attach is abnormal. First is CS fallback not preferred, and for this case we need to check the CS fallback feature on the core network. Then we have the abnormal attach where it is attached for SMS only, and in that case we also need to check the CS fallback feature. The third case is EPS only, and in this case we need to check the EMM calls value and check the TALA mapping. There might be an issue in that. And the The cause of this abnormal attach, whenever the UI requires CS fallback procedure, it will fail because it is not attached to provide these services. We can now look at the paging failure for mobile terminating calls for CS fallback in a bit more detail. If the user is going through a tracking area update while returning to LTE from legacy WAN, paging would fail in some of the vendor products, and this varies from vendor to vendor, but this is in some case an issue. Then paging will fail if the LTE network has implicitly detached the UE. This is the case where the MME on its inactivity timer basically detaches the UE from the LTE network, and this issue can also be worked out using the inactivity timers for the UE detach from the network. The first issue of tracking area update can also be optimized by optimizing the tracking area boundaries for LTE. The third part for the paging failure is poor coverage, leading to the message not received by the UE. It's a very generic coverage issue, and it can be resolved by RF optimization. Another issue is paging not issued by the core network. So this is basically a core network issue, and the core network team needs to check into this. Then we have an issue of not enough physical downlink common control channels available in terms of the CCE. And in the last, if we have a paging reject message by the user, and the paging reject can be by a number of reasons. That is, IMZ is detached for EPS services, or IMZ is unknown, or IMZ is detached for non-EPS services, or it is just rejected by the user. The RRC connection release is an important step in the CS fallback procedure. In the RRC connection release command, the eNode B includes all the relevant information for the user to access the legacy network. There can be two cases. The first case is that the UE has received the RRC connection release, and the second case is that the RRC connection release request has not been received. So the first case is if it has been received, we need to see if it contains the CS fallback frequency or not. Second case is we can need to check if there is a handover command before the RRC connection release. And third case is check if there is a tracking area update procedure going on during or before the RRC connection release. If we have not received the RRC connection release, I think the first thing should be you should check the coverage. Sometimes because of poor coverage, the RRC connection release request is lost, and therefore we have a CS fallback failure. In addition to that, we should check if the channel CS fallback feature is enabled. Secondly, we need to check if the CS fallback 2G frequency is configured or not. And thirdly, we need to check if we are having some implicit detach issues in the network. As a recap, in this slide, we are trying to show the main KPIs that are included in CS fallback optimization and monitoring. The first one is CS fallback paging success rate, and you can basically see the two points where this success test is calculated. The second one is CS fallback call success rate, that is a CS fallback call fallback structure. That is basically defines the success rate for the UE to fall back from LTE to the legacy network. Then basically the third one is the CS fallback call connection success rate. So it includes from the paging request or from the initial request to the point where the call is successfully set up in the legacy network. And the third one is basically your CS fallback return to LTE success rate. And along with these, we also have the setup time for the call setup, and also the return time to the LTE, which are basic KPIs used for performance optimization and monitoring of this whole CS fallback feature. In terms of CS fallback, another important feature is fallback RAT frequency configuration. There are a number of parameters that need to be configured so that in the RRC connection release, the correct RAT frequency and the correct RAT is selected for the CS fallback. One parameter is CS fallback trial, which basically defines the RAN frequency to be accessed for CS fallback combined with the UE capability. This parameter basically gives the priority to each of the frequency band available for different RATs. Then we have defined relationships between GSM and WCDNSLs that are indicated by UTRAN frequency relation and GRAN frequency relation. And then we have the number of ARFCN defined for neighbor relation and linked with setup times. So basically all of these factors are important for the fallback success and also for optimizing the fallback procedure. The call setup time latency optimization is one of the most important features for CS fallback optimization because the call setup time in CS fallback is significant, and even the UE sometimes is able to note the longer durations. There are different redirect modes with the DMCR and RIM features as described earlier. They are available to reduce the call setup times, and in the detailed training we can basically provide a very nice comparison of how much time we can reduce for each of these features. Then we have twice paging and other paging parameters on the SGS interface between MME and the MSC. We can also work with idle and connected mode and increase in call setup time. Basically, if these are timers used in LTE to move the mobile from the idle to the connected mode, and this can result in also a significant impact on the call setup time. Then we have the data interruption times for PS services, and in all basically in a summary we can say that there are a number of ways to improve the call setup times. It depends on the feature available and the approach that we use. Another aspect of CS fallback is the time taken for the UE to return from the legacy network to LTE. This is called as return to LTE latency. There are different procedures to return to the LTE network. First of all is the interest RAT service selection. Basically, the procedure is to give a higher priority to LTE, and whenever the call is finished, there's a normal reselection procedure based on the availability of whatever RAT is available. And subsequently, if all the conditions are met, then the LTE network is reselected. However, the latency is quite significant for this reselection procedure. So there's another feature called 2G, 3G feature release with redirect to LTE. So basically what happens is that upon the call completion, there's a redirect to LTE. And then there's another feature called fast return to LTE. All of these procedures are aimed at reducing the time it takes for the UE to return from the legacy network to the LTE. And in our on-site and online training, we can discuss these in further detail. To summarize, in this lecture, we have discussed CS fallback functionality in LTE for voice services based on legacy 2G, 3G networks. Then CS fallback architecture and network entities plus functions, and then CS fallback KPIs, issues, and optimization techniques. We can, of course, go into a lot more details for CS fallback and the detailed optimization techniques, but for that, of course, an on-site and online dedicated session would be required. For any further queries and questions, you can contact me on my contact information given in the summary slide. And I wish all of you all the best and happy learning.